They were America's royal family, but for decades it seemed the Kennedys were cursed. It started with the assassination of President JFK, who was assassinated in Dallas, then Bobby Kennedy, who was murdered. Growing up in the Kennedy clan led Christopher Kennedy Lawford to battle his own demons. He self-medicated with alcohol and drugs. However, he is now clean and sober and spends his life helping others to overcome their personal demons. Please welcome Christopher to Studio 10. Welcome to the show. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Lovely to meet you.
You guys are having entirely too much fun out here.
Oh, yeah. happens too often.
Good for you.
And your addiction started out, I suppose you've called it the perfect addiction storm. You did drugs with your dad at some point as well?
Yeah, at some point. Yeah, it was a different time. Neither one of us would do that today, but... But I think this is an illness that depends a lot on genetics. It depends, a lot of trauma. I had a lot of trauma. So I was a sitting duck for this.
Yeah, well, speaking of trauma, I mean, the Kennedys, of course, are famously, tragically linked to that. You had one uncle, JFK, of course, was shot and killed in 1963. And then 5 years later, Bobby Kennedy was killed as he was running for president. Right. And that really...
Yeah, I remember my friends, you know, it was a different culture back then. I mean, that drugs were epidemic, people were doing it, it was sort of an okay thing to do. And I was in seventh grade and my friends were trying to get me to drop acid with them. And I said, no, wow. I actually want to do something great in this world. I came from a family that was productive, that wanted to help, you know, to do good things in the world. And I said, no. And then when my Uncle Bobby was shot, they asked me again and I said, yeah. And I didn't realize at that time that I was an angry, a terrified kid. I was 13 years old who was looking for something to make me feel better. And drugs and alcohol for a lot of children are great medication. They don't work, and they will turn on you, but they deal with the issue, which is trauma and the trauma of adolescence.
Take us inside your addiction. How bad did things get in your life?
It got bad. I mean, but I always had the resume. I went to college, I went to law school, I got a master's certification in clinical psychology from Harvard while fully enmeshed in my active addiction. So a lot of alcoholics, a lot of drug addicts, a lot of people with process addictions are enormously functional in the world, but they're not having a good time. Mm. And they're not really there. So
both your parents had they were both alcoholics, weren't they? Your father in particular.
Yeah.
And in fact, you look like your old man. I must say, you do look like Peter Lawford.
Thank
you. I remember his movies.
He's very handsome.
So do I.
And as you'd mentioned, you know, you had taken drugs with your dad, but also, you know, he was a member of the Rat Pack.
Yeah.
And is it right that Marilyn Monroe taught you how to do the twist?
She did.
I mean, that's extraordinary.
And when I tell people that, especially men, they go, "Wow, Marilyn Monroe taught you how to do the twist." What was that like? I have to remind them that I was six at the time. But
wow, any older.
I had some very, very amazing women who I was socialized to from a very young age.
If you were a functioning alcoholic and a functioning drug addict, then what made you get sober? Because you hear lots of people talking about hitting
thing about this illness. People think, oh, well, they're having a good time. They're drinking. They're not. Nobody that's an addict is having a good time. That's the first thing. Those of you out there that are watching this, really understand this illness, because the people that you know that are doing this are not doing it because they're having fun. They're not doing it because they want to. They're doing it because they have a compulsion to do it. It's a brain illness. And people that drink and drug would like a different life. Mm. So for me, what happened was I did two things right. I didn't die. I almost did four times. And I always wanted to get better. So if you're going to knock on a door 500 times before that door opens, are you going to stop at 499? No. So I kept knocking.
You're here for some work with a rehabilitation centre in Sydney, the South Pacific
private. They do amazing work. Mm. They do amazing work with trauma, with family, with addictions. They do
because,
great work.
As you say, with family, it's not just the individual. Addiction has an enormous impact on people around the addict, it can be very hard to care for, to love someone who is some type of addict. How can you best support someone? Because often you just want to walk away.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I wrote a book called When Your Partner Has an Addiction, which is coming out this fall. And it's about that. It's about really being able... We know from the research today that family members and partners can have a dramatic impact on whether somebody gets well. Mm. And you have to assume that everybody wants to get well, because they do, no matter how badly they behave. Mm. And we're not saying you stay with somebody that behaves badly, puts your life is a threat to your life or a threat to your security, but you can make a huge difference in somebody's life if you partner with them and you do it compassionately.
How do you do that, though, when you just want to go, you know what, you are more than a pain in the ass?
Very difficult. Listen, this is the way this disease presents is the most difficult for others to accept.
Yeah.
And it's really difficult.
They talk a lot about the addictive gene, and I'm damn sure I've got it. Right. But of course, JFK was addicted to painkillers because of back problems. Right. Do you think... as a Kennedy, you're more predisposed to
addiction? It definitely
runs
in families, and it runs in my family to a large degree. It doesn't mean that if you have the... And this is the interesting thing. If you look at families, people go, well, we didn't have any alcoholics or drug addicts, but maybe you had somebody that weighed 300 pounds, that used food, or that was a sex and love addiction.
You loved sugar, didn't you,
That was my first drug, was sugar.
Mm. Well, what was... You spent a long period of your life addicted, and now you're sober. What is the most dramatic change that you know in yourself from going through the rehabilitation?
The thing that we know little about today is recovery. I've been in recovery for 30 years. Mm. I talk a lot today. I talk a lot today about what recovery is and what it should be. We're just beginning to investigate this. And the truth is, those of us who have been through this, we've had our worst day. We've gone to the gates of hell. Mm. We come out and we're able to get our lives back, and we're able to find our own authentic self. The greatest gift I've gotten in my recovery is not realizing I was a Kennedy or realizing all of that. It's realizing who I am. Mm. I wanted to be Tom Cruise when I got here. I don't want to be Tom Cruise anymore. I'm happy being me.
Our country is in the grip of an ICE epidemic at the moment. It is destroying families, destroying ordinary people. It is just off the charts horrible. Right. In the United States, just recently, we saw a mother and her partner who were drugged out on heroin. Their photo was taken. Did you see that photo?
No.
That was taken. It was taken in a car of them basically passed out on heroin, and it was basically put out as a public service saying, drugs can do.
Yeah, but they had a little child in the front seat.
They did. Right. How do you then stop an epidemic? How do you keep...
It starts with education. It starts with by everybody getting concerned. For the first time in America now, we have, in the presidential election, we have this as an issue. Mm. People are talking about it. Both candidates, well, Donald Trump isn't talking about much except building walls and such. But truthfully, it is an issue in the campaign. Mm. It's a policy issue. President Obama has done a lot with his bully pulpit in terms of making this an issue. It's about education. My family wanted to help me desperately, but they had no information about this thing. One of my kids is sober. She got sober when she was 19 years old. She just celebrated 7 years of recovery. She was able to do that because she had parents who were in recovery and understood about this illness. Yeah. That's where it changes. It changes around the dinner table.
Good on you.
If you or someone you love is experiencing difficulties with mental health concerns, depression or addiction, you can call South Pacific Private on 02-9466-6461 or go online to the website, which is on your screen. Now, we would love to talk to you all morning, but we've run out of time.
I'll come back.
Thank you.
Oh, please do.